Jacob, this is our last time this year that we will be able to talk like this. So looking forward to next year and what the Lord's going to do. Just wanted to go over some current events in light of Bible prophecy. We'll shoot him off really quick. Give us your insight. People love to hear from you. People love to have your insights and to know what they are and what Moriel is doing and what the Lord has for Moriel this coming year as you see from the Lord's working and the Holy Spirit what he's teaching us and what he's teaching you specifically. And we'll get to that at the end. But let's get through some news very quickly because there's lots going on. And not for the sake of news, but for the sake of the Bible and sake of Bible prophecy. This idea of fake news, this idea that Congress, it's just recently passed 6393, which is the Intelligence Authorization Act of the fiscal year 2017, passed by the Senate, 390-37 votes, I believe it was, which basically says they will go after anyone in particular that is they see as fake news, because they created this Ministry of Truth, what they call it, a de facto Ministry of Truth. Was passed on December 8th. Are we moving into a time in the States where we're having like an Orwellian type nightmare of 1984 where speech, thought, is going to be not only legislated, but also you'll be punished and judged by thinking and what they consider fake news?
What you'll have is the criminalization of opinion. Political correctness gone mad. This works both ways. It can work from the left and it can work from the right. Let's remember, we call it Orwellian, but it was commonplace in the Soviet Union with Izvestia and Pravda.
That's right.
Truth was not what objectively transpires or transpired. The determination of truth is the party line. What the party said, that was truth, irrespective of whatever factually actually took place or didn't take place. That was irrelevant to the establishment of truth. Truth was whatever the party declared it to be. That was the name of the publications. Truth, they called them truth in Russian. Well, we are moving towards that progressively in the West. Free speech. Now, we can talk about journalistic responsibility. What is utterly hypocritical are the people who are the proponents of this kind of opposition to fake news are themselves the authors of it.
Correct.
I think particularly of Hillary Clinton, when she said she got into Bosnia and
with the shooting.
Landing on the fire, and the little girl comes up and gives her the flowers. I mean, it's fake news. Fake news.
The Benghazi video.
Obviously, Benghazi. And Obama himself lied about it.
Correct.
It wasn't just Hillary Clinton, it was Obama.
Yeah.
And lied to the families of the victims. And we're caught lying. This is just fake news. But then the utter absurdity. For instance, we know that Barack Obama and his wife attended Jeremiah Wright's church for years, gave him $500 a week to that church.
Yeah.
They gave platform, pulpit, to Louis Farrakhan, to racists, to all kinds of people. When Farrakhan was saying that he rode over Chicago in a flying saucer,
right.
This is what they had speaking in the church. But the message of Jeremiah Wright was literally, he preached goddamn America.
Yes.
That was what he actually preached from the pulpit. And the left-wing media gave Obama a complete pass.
Correct.
A complete pass.
Well, Obama's calling now for state-run media.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But then when you had Bannon was appointed by Mr. Trump.
Yes.
He was accused of being involved with the alt-right and being anti-Semitic. Well, his editor at large is Ben Shapiro, an Orthodox Jew who he hired, who wears a yarmulke to work and takes the Jewish holidays off. And he's the editor at large of Breitbart. Alan Dershowitz, obviously liberal Jew,
correct,
law professor at Harvard, said there's no possible way this person is an anti-Semite or a racist. But they just invent it. You have identity politics.
Yeah.
To understand the way this works, it is Olenskyism. Olenskyism. If you have something with a female, and she's a left-wing female, you just begin screaming, sexism, sexism. Now, when the boots are on the other feet, and some of the most verbally abusive, not just insulting, but calumnious statements were made against someone like Sarah Palin.
Right.
or Barbara Bachman, it was no problem. No problem.
But when it's done to them.
But when you're critical of Hillary Clinton, oh, it's sexism. It's sexism.
Yeah.
Likewise with racism. If I was a black person, and the greatest pediatric neurosurgeon of our time, the only person to successfully separate encephalophagocytomies twins, and they lived, Dr. Ben Carson, I would be proud that he was a member of my ethnicity. Or when you have a rocket scientist like Herman Cain. A rocket scientist, a mathematical expert in ballistics and a rocket scientist for the Navy, who becomes a very successful businessman, I would be proud of Herman Cain. When you have the best political economist in the world, Professor Walter Williams, an Afro-American, I'd be proud of him. Or when you have the best social economist in the world, Dr. Thomas Sowell, I'd be proud of him. But when you get these Afro-Americans who are achieved, who are accomplished, and who see through the manipulation of minorities, they're ashamed of them.
They demonize them.
They ridicule the people who should be putting up on a platform as role models become vilified.
Yes.
And you get Al Sharpton instead. A man who can't even speak a sentence with proper grammar, you know, a grandstanding opportunist, a phony, a liar.
Yeah.
You get Who in their right mind needs Al Sharpton when you have a pediatric neurosurgeon who's like Ben Carson?
Yeah. Well, Al Sharpton says the biggest problem in the 21st century is carbon. That's the problem in the world. The biggest threat to the world is carbon.
Yeah, that man probably does not even know that carbon dioxide is to plants what oxygen is to humans.
That's right. Well, that's who they have as the role model.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
It's Alinskyism. It's based on a Goebbels. It's not originally with Alinsky. It was Goebbels.
Right, Hitler.
You keep a lie often enough, and people will think it's the truth.
Well, Facebook is getting into this idea now that they're going to censor news through Snopes, which known to be a left-wing liberal. Yeah. And so right now, ministries, churches, individual Christians are being censored, are going to be censored. They're going to be called fake news. Is this the beginning of a persecution that begins in the media and is going to
drill? It will be like the Book of Daniel. Remember the Book of Daniel? They were keen to get laws on the books.
Yes.
Once the laws were on the books, they were used against the people of God.
That's it.
They will surreptitiously get legislation that would appear innocuous initially, but there's an agenda on back of it. I'm not saying a conspiracy, but an agenda. Once they get those laws in place, they will be selectively applied against believers.
Yeah.
That's what's going to happen. Look, Hillary Clinton. We have people in the military who were criminally prosecuted and court-martialed for what she did.
A tenth of what she did.
Yeah. And then the FBI said she had no intent. Well, those other people had no intent either. They're simply reckless. They were careless and irresponsible with classified material. But she walks.
Right.
Her husband, who's a material witness, meets with the attorney general 2 days before the FBI issues its decision. Open corruption. Open corruption. But the law is always selectively applied. They will selectively apply the law. Yeah.
The laws. The news. CNN. Which has been,
CNN used to be the Clinton News Network. Now it's the Crybaby News Network.
Yeah, MSNBC. Even Fox News is getting into this. Nobody could actually take them seriously anymore. However, they have a great deal of an audience with left-wing millennials, liberals, that have really turned any form of conservatism, any form of Judeo-Christian values. They have demonized them. They have literally destroyed anybody who stands up to them.
Essentially, what has happened, to a degree, whether you like Rupert Murdoch or not, the Wall Street Journal, the New York Post, and Fox Business News particularly, have been more objective than the mainstream left-wing press.
Right.
That may change in the coming year, with the semi-retirement of Rupert Murdoch, who's now...
Well, his son's running it now.
Yeah, now his son's both alleged to have left-wing leanings.
Yeah.
And he's married. He's busy trying to keep up with his new wife, Jerry Hall. He used to be married to Mick Jagger. He's got enough on his plate. So he's letting the kids run the enterprise. And what's a 90-year-old man doing with the Fox
Well, not only that, but Jacob, we have now religious figures getting into this, and this is fascinating to hear the Pope, who is no friend of ours, who has basically said, if you've gone into this fake news and posting things against the government, you're sinning. And second of all, you are going against the government, which is a sin, but also you're fascinated with excrement.
You have to understand why he's saying that. When he was the archbishop in Buenos Aires, Argentina, he refused to meet with the families and the children who were sexually abused by the priests. You had widespread pedophilia in Argentina throughout Latin America, underreported because of Opus Dei and the influence of the Roman Catholic Church by allegation popularly. He refused to meet them. Now in Italy, you have actual laws going back to the Lateran Treaty that Mussolini made with the Pope, restricting criticism of the papacy and the Vatican.
Right.
The Vatican has its own newspaper, Osservatorio Romano, the Roman Observer. But if you read like Corriere della Sera, the Evening News and things like this, they're restricted by Italian law in their capacity to be critical of the Vatican.
Oh.
The Vatican was immersed in the Ambrosioni bank scandal, the Calvi affair. Over 200 people died.
But they didn't report it.
Over 200 people died by assassination. The Vatican paid hundreds of millions of dollars in compensation to try to get their way out of it. But it actually happened. This actually happened. They didn't like it getting into the newspapers. They did not want it there. They did not want anything like this. There are already restrictions in Italy. What the Pope would like to do is extend that. You've had the widespread pedophilia has damaged the Roman Catholic Church significantly, both in its standing and its moral credibility, but it's hurt financially. In Los Angeles alone, just here where we are, in Los Angeles alone, the cost of keeping Cardinal Mahoney out of prison in compensation and law fees is nearly
$1 billion.
I think San Diego, 130.
And that's just here.
That's just here.
Not Ireland?
That's just here.
Yeah.
That's just here. In Ireland, every bishop has been caught. Can you imagine the biggest seminary, Roman Catholic seminary in Europe, in Vienna, Austria, and the cardinal who'd been a friend of the Pope knew about it, been a friend of Pope John Paul II, knew about it, 40,000 hours. 40,000 hours of film of pedophilia and homosexuality, and homosexual pedophilia. 40,000 hours!
Incredible.
Unbelievable! This is the biggest Roman Catholic seminary in continental Europe. The Vatican has a vested interest in sequestering these things.
I think we have the quote from, it's somebody running the PowerPoint. We have the quote of Pope Francis. That's the Pravda news.
Yeah, that means truth in Russian.
Right, it's Vestia too, right? The Soviet Union news.
Yes.
I think we have the. Oh, there he is, his Pontificus Maximus. But let's go to the quote. Let's go to the quote that he. I think it's on the next slide, where he says it's a sin, where he says it's excrement, where he says it's. You know, China's even get into the censorship as well.
Yes.
I mean, it seems a collective effort to really shut down anything that goes against the party line, but also the globalist line. There it is.
Media that focuses on scandals and spread fake news to smear politicians risk becoming like people who have a morbid fascination with excrement. That's what the Pope said.
Yeah.
Now, what about people who criminally conspire to protect pedophile clergy at the expense of not protecting the children whose lives they destroy? Would they go in that category? I don't think so, according to Pope Francis.
Pope Francis.
Let's understand Francis. He said, if two men are in a same-sex relationship, who is he to judge? God has already judged. Is Romans chapter 1 not in his New Testament?
Right.
Not that he cares about it. This is who you're speaking about. One of the things you see is that people will refer to the Pope, or they will refer to the United Nations.
Right, as a way
or the Supreme Court, as if they carry some kind of moral credibility.
Right.
They carry no moral credibility. They're morally discredited. The Supreme Court once decided that a black person was subhuman with the Dred Scott decision. The same U.S. Supreme Court that dehumanized black people.
Right.
Dehumanized fetuses, even though the fetuses can survive
outside
earlier and earlier in gestation. Yeah. They simply dehumanize them as a politically motivated legal decision. The Supreme Court has no moral credibility. The United Nations has no moral credibility. The biggest voting bloc in the UN General Assembly are 57 Muslim countries. Not one of them is a democracy. Not one will give Christians and Jews the freedom they get in America or Britain or Canada.
That's right.
Or Australia or any Western country. Not one of them. On the United Nations Human Rights Commission, you've got nations who are members who have the most notorious record of human rights abuses imaginable. Yet people say the UN, the UN.
Yeah.
It is as if it has some kind of moral credence. It has zero moral credence.
The Pope just basically forgave abortions just recently.
He said, in essence?
Yeah, he basically said, if you have abortions, I forgive your sins.
In essence.
Yeah.
But we gave other priests the right to do it.
Yeah.
But in essence, but you know, he's a commensurate politician, speaks out of both sides of his mouth. The so-called conservatives in the Roman Church will say, oh, he hasn't changed the church's official policy.
Right.
But homosexual Catholic listening to what he said will say he did.
Basically, he has.
Yeah, it's just complete hypocrisy.
Now,
it's about politics.
People that are going against the Pope, people that are going against the government, people that are going and speaking against Hillary, against the Democratic DNC, they're automatically labeled the new McCarthyism, Russians.
That's
you're a
Zelenskyism.
Russian agent. Yeah.
That is Zelenskyism.
So Christians are being called Russian agents.
Well, look, when Hillary Clinton did what she did, putting her emails on a private server, you know very well that the Iranians, the Russians,
and the Chinese,
yes. were all trying to hack. It would be impossible to imagine that they wouldn't at least attempt it.
Correct.
The left-wing media didn't say a word. Now, all of a sudden, although there's no evidence that the Russians swayed the American election, it becomes an issue.
Right.
It is all hypocrisy. One of the things that happens is the left sells a bill of goods that they care about homosexuals, or they care about minorities,
or
they
the
care
poor.
About Hispanics,
yeah.
they care about blacks. They couldn't care less.
That's right.
They're just stooges, patsies. They, you know, what happened when Clinton was president? He tripled the Afro-American prison population.
Correct.
You know, he tripled it.
Yeah.
He tripled it. He doesn't care. Obama was against it. Same-sex marriage, Clinton was against same-sex
marriage.
Right,
at the beginning. And
as soon as it becomes politically inexpedient, they change their position.
Right.
These people have no commitment to anything ideologically. They're only about money and power.
I know African-American believers who say they've done nothing but to destroy our race. They've done nothing but to destroy our communities. They have nothing to destroy Chicago, Detroit. They're complete bankrupt cities because...
Well, when you have a 58% increase in people on food stamps under Barack Obama, a 58% increase. When black unemployment has become so bad that they're telling people that the long-term unemployed are not unemployed. In other words, labor participation. When somebody gives up looking for a job and goes on welfare and food stamps permanently, they no longer count them as unemployed.
That's right.
This has particularly hit minority communities. On top of that, black home ownership is at an all-time low. Afro-American home ownership is at an all-time low.
Yeah.
He's left-wing. He was pro-Obama, a journalist named Tavis Smiley. He has believers in his family. Mm. I don't think he's a believer, but he's a prominent Afro-American journalist, maybe the preeminent one in certain circles. He wrote an article in the Huffington Post. He's pro-Obama.
Yeah.
He's left-wing himself, admitting that the economic plight of Afro-Americans under Obama has not improved in any major category after 8 years.
Hmm.
Now, Obama bailed out banks.
Yes.
What did he do for his own people? Put them on a breadline?
None.
The absolute disgusting hypocrisy. When you are allowing drugs to come in across the border from Mexico to fuel gang-related violence in the major cities, and black and Hispanic youth are being gunned down in the streets, and you say if you want to seal the border, that's anti-black, anti-Hispanic.
Yeah, anti-minority.
Where are the drugs coming from that are killing these kids?
Yeah.
And every one of the cities, as you point out, are ones with Democrat governments and mayors.
Absolutely.
Every one.
Absolutely.
Goes beyond that. You came here as a refugee legally from Guatemala, yeah? Or
Nicaragua. Yeah.
Okay. To allow illegals who don't have to go on Obamacare, who don't have to do a lot of things.
Right.
They don't have to work for minimum
wage.
They
got a lot of exceptions.
They can get circumvent the minimum wage.
Yeah.
To take jobs from Black and Hispanic Americans, to jump the queue, to jump the line, and take jobs that belong to Latin Americans who immigrated here legally.
Yeah.
This is an outrage. It's our own minorities, our own urban poor,
who are being
hurt by this illegal immigration the most, and they're being made as the victim. The unbelievable lies.
Jacob, you mentioned
that. But there is a change.
Which one?
15% of Black American men voted for Trump.
Yes, 15, there is
that's
a change.
Not huge, but it's big compared to what it was.
Yeah.
17%.
More than in Romney.
17%. 29% of Hispanics. 26% of Hispanic women. They are not all easily manipulated.
No, especially business owners. Hispanic business owners overwhelmingly voted for Trump.
Oh, yes. Because of these restrictions and regulations that you're putting on small and medium-sized businesses.
That's right.
How can these people become upwardly mobile?
You mentioned, Jacob, that in the melting pot of America, is what they call it, you have minority groups, which are becoming more than minority. You have Hispanics and the Chinese Asians. They literally have surpassed, basically, the African-American community. They have the jobs. They have the education.
This is what bothers me. This is what bothers me. The name of the game is to create a permanent underclass with a victim mentality to hold the Blacks and the Hispanics down. What the Democrat Party today is, it is no longer the Democratic Party of JFK and of Scoop Jackson and of Joseph Lieberman. It's no longer that kind of Democrats. It's something completely different now. They have the same old agenda. It is Jim Crow with a smile. Gore, Al Gore, Southern Democrat, his father was a rabid segregationist who voted against civil rights. The Clintons, Bill Clinton's mentor, George Favor, a radical segregationist, was completely against racial integration in the South. Hillary Clinton's mentor, Byrd. He was in the Klan.
Yes.
The man was in the Klan.
She said it was more influential man in her life.
The most influential man came from the Klan. What they're doing now is what they always did with a smile. After slavery, it was Jim Crow. You arrest as many Blacks as possible and put them on a chain gang. Slavery with a different name.
Yes.
The Klan was lynching them, okay? Killing Blacks, imprisoning Blacks, okay? Keeping a permanent underclass. Disarm the Blacks so they couldn't defend themselves.
That's right.
Gun control aimed at the Blacks. So what are they doing now? Suspend the Second Amendment, particularly prevent honest black citizens from exercising their rights to have
protection.
The means to protect themselves from the gang violence. Okay. This was the Southern Democrats who wanted to disarm them so they couldn't protect themselves from the Klan.
Same story.
Who couldn't defend themselves from the Klan doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Clinton tripled the Black prison population, put them back on the chain gang.
Yeah.
And then abortion on demand. Same thing they always did with Blacks. Kill them, put them in chains,
and keep them as
a permanent underclass.
That's right.
That Blasio in New York
is
a disgrace. His war against these charter schools and these vouchers.
Yeah.
The teachers' unions are nothing but a political campaign fund for the Democratic Party.
Yeah.
They don't represent good teachers, only bad ones.
Mm.
Good teachers are underpaid, particularly in the sciences and math.
Yes.
They're underpaid. These other ones are getting tenured. And we spend more per capita per student on public education than any other developed country with the worst possible results.
Yes.
The more they spend, the less they get. They're throwing the money out the window.
That's right.
So somebody comes along and says, let's give these people vouchers. Let's have competition.
Yeah.
The only thing going to make a difference here is education. No, you're threatening the status quo.
That's right.
This is a political campaign fund for the Democratic Party. But not only that, it is a mechanism of social engineering.
That's right.
To keep these people down.
Yeah.
Let us look at San Francisco, here in California.
Yeah.
Okay. You go through the rundown districts of San Francisco, like the Mission District.
Okay.
They are turning those buildings into condos. instead of people working in the suburbs, living in the suburbs and working in the city, it's the reverse now. They're buying condos in the city and taking the Google buses to Silicon Valley. They're condoizing those buildings. Blacks are being driven out, forced into the ghettos across the bridge in Oakland, right?
Right.
This is San Francisco now. Then you make it a city of refuge. So illegal immigrants come in and take their jobs.
Yeah.
And then the people who run Silicon Valley, 85% of them are liberal Democrats. And they think they're for the blacks. This is absolutely absurd.
Yeah.
So you go into Silicon Valley, here's what you have. One-third of those high-paid jobs, one-third of those high-paid jobs are Asians, not Asian Americans. Many of them, a probable majority, are people who came here to do postgraduate degrees at Stanford,
right,
at Berkeley, at Caltech. They're getting corporate subsidies, corporate sponsorships for their PhDs.
This is a H-1B1
visa. Yeah, they're getting H-1B1 visa. Yeah. They're getting corporate sponsorships for their PhDs, and they're being recruited by these high-tech companies. One-third of these people. These are jobs that begin at 80, 90,000 a year.
Right.
Begin at 80, 90,000 a year, okay? Some of the jobs begin that high. And it's not unusual. One-third of those jobs are Asians. Two-thirds are diverse,
others,
mostly
yeah,
whites, a few Hispanics. Afro-Americans, less than 2%. Hispanics, not much better.
Hmm.
What's happening here? The Hispanics demographically now have the numbers, the vote.
They have the vote.
Okay. And don't forget, Hispanics begin three times as many small businesses.
That's true.
As non-Hispanics.
That's right.
Three times, Hispanics open businesses three times faster than non-Hispanics in the United States. So they have the numbers and the upward mobility. Asians have the education and the numbers. Indians have the casinos.
Yes.
Not that they're not entitled to it.
Right.
What do the blacks have?
Nothing.
Nothing. They get shafted. Obama bailed out the banks. What did he do for his own people?
No.
It's all a scam. It's Jim Crow with a smile.
Right. I mean, the DNC is even counting job growth within the black community as going on food stamps. So if you go on food stamps, that's a job growth.
Yeah, that's
how they count it. It is. It's
but, you know,
laughable.
It was a mainstream Democrat before the Democrat Party became what it is. Patrick Moynihan, senator from New York. In the 1960s, he's the first one who warned that the federal government is waging war against Afro-American families with the welfare state, where they're turning the welfare check and the food stamps into the replacement for a
mom
husband
and dad,
and a father.
That's right.
And that's it.
Yeah.
So now you've got 3 out of 4 Afro-American children born out of wedlock. The statistical predisposition to winding up in the criminal justice system and dropping out of school, high school now, is astronomically higher when you have a non-nuclear family. It's a disgrace, and it's socially engineered, and it's intended to be that way.
Yeah.
And then the blacks who see through this, the people who they should listen to, are scorned.
Yeah.
Are scorned.
Yeah.
It's absolutely a disgrace.
Yeah. And unfortunately, they've abandoned, as a society, we've abandoned the gospel. But within the community, they've abandoned the gospel for Islam. Now that you have the Nation of Islam, they turn to Muslim.
You know, I'll tell you something. When I was a kid going to Florida for vacation with my parents, I come from New York, New Jersey. I remember going through the South before the interstate highways were built, before I-95 was built, was Highway 301, U.S. 301. And I remember white only, this is Klan country.
Hmm.
I remember black people living in shacks with no plumbing, no indoor plumbing, little electricity, looked like the third world. I remember Jim Crow.
Hmm.
I remember what that was like.
Hmm.
I remember what that was like. I know what it was like. The party of slavery were the Democrats.
Always, that's
the
right.
The party of Jim Crow were the Democrats. And now they're doing the same thing they
again
always did,
but with a smile.
Doing it with a smile.
That's right. Now, turning to what our society has become, Jacob, many have called it cultural Marxism really rules the world here. And it's really destroying America is what really have people said. And people are finding out if you talk about it, though, it makes people uncomfortable. It makes people not wanting to deal with the reality of it. But it's really changed society. I have a couple of videos, but I wanted you to watch this video. So I want you to comment after the second one. Because this is what it has brought forth in our nation, a confusion. I want you to define what cultural Marxism is after this, because it's really has turned our society upside down and is destroying America. So when you guys are ready, let's play the two clips, whichever one first on the either the cover girl one and the boy or girl one, either one, but back to back if you can play them so we can comment on it. This is from the BBC. This is one of the most popular videos in the BBC.
The single most common question I get asked is, are you a boy or are you a girl? The simple answer is no. But then the response after that is usually a very confused, what? So here is the explanation. I am non-binary, and that means I identify as something other than male or female. Our society and history has led us to believe over thousands of years that there are only people who are male and people who are female. But that is because past society has based gender on physical sex.
Let me see what it is, nurse. Ah, yes, what a strapping young lad.
It's outdated. The truth is that gender is in the brain, and physical sex is a completely separate and different thing that is private to every individual. What people really mean when they're asking the boy or girl question is creepily, so, what genitals do you have? People need to realize it doesn't matter what living meat skeleton you've been born in, it's what you feel that defines you. Non-binary is a blanket term for anyone who identifies out with the binary gender. There are endless ways of being non-binary, and no two people identify in the same way. So just remember, gender is what you feel, not what your parts are. Don't be afraid to be yourself. Bye, guys.
Today is a great day for lash equality. New So Lashy mascara works for all lash types.
Light, straight, short, fine.
The breakthrough? The unique Lash Finder tip. It turns every little lash into bold, sexy,
so lashy
lashes.
For me,
for us,
for all.
Celebrate lash equality with new So Lashy mascara.
From easy breezy,
equal is beautiful.
CoverGirl.
Equality, transgenderism, binary.
Okay.
This is what we have today.
There are three aspects of this. The first one you already touched on. The fact is Western society is post-Judeo-Christian. The family values that framed the Western world have dissipated radically. This is not only in the minority communities. It is not only in the minority communities. Again, traditional Black and Hispanic Pentecostal, Black and Hispanic Catholicism, Pentecostalism, and the Baptist churches.
Right.
They had a tremendous cultural influence in reinforcing family values in the minority communities. You take that away, what's left? But it's not just the minority communities. Hmm. The whole Western society is post-Judeo-Christian. Second, post-modernism. Reality becomes suspended. No matter what they tell you, the DNA in every cell of their bodies, you're either double X, or XY. Occasionally, you get a super male who's double Y, but they're very rare phenomena. Everyone is either XY or they are double X. That is what they are. It's not what you feel, it's what you are. What you are is what you are genetically. The death of reason is a message that we taught once concerning this, and how this death of reason has permeated the church. Objective reality is genetic. Nobody in the age of recombinant DNA can possibly say your gender is what you feel. Your gender is what you are.
I think we have a screenshot of 58, I believe these are 58 different genders that you can apply to in New York City. 31 are accepted. You could be a pelican if you wanted to.
You know,
I mean, we passed the point, Jacob. I mean, we're trying to make fun, laughable, and make fun of it to some degree. But it's a serious thing. We passed this Romans 1 scenario where
we've passed it because God has given people over to it.
Incredible.
Incredibly, the first person I know who saw this coming was I didn't know him well, but I had met him and spoke to him. The first person I saw this coming, this is going back to the 1970s, the late pop star David Bowie. He saw this coming. He said this was going to be the future reality. He probably got this from Andy Warhol, a pop artist. There were people in the artistic community who foresaw this coming. They called it androgyny. That's what they called it.
Right.
They called it, the term then was androgyny.
Yeah.
And they thought that it would blossom in what became known as Generation X.
Right.
Before the millennials, the Generation X. They thought it would blossom because of a social disorientation that took place after the hippie generation. After the hippie generation, there'd be no cause anymore.
Okay.
People would not have a cause. It would just be based on experience. Andy Warhol said, people now are looking for truth and peace. That's not going to matter 10 years from now. He was right. David Bowie saw this. Mm. I remember these guys. I talked to these. Well, I knew people in those circles fairly well. And they saw it coming before sociologists.
Interesting.
They saw it coming before sociologists. I suppose I wouldn't call them prophets in any biblical sense, but they were certainly socially prophetic.
Correct.
The people I had contact with saw it coming. Now, it was an underground culture of after-hours bars in New York. We had transvestites, drag queens, people like this that I hung out with, got high with, whatever, before I was walking with the Lord. I knew people like this. I knew people like it. You know, and Bobby would sing, got your mother in the world, don't know if you're a boy or a girl. He was singing this stuff 25, 30 years ago before this happened. He knew that it was going to come to this. The artist perceived it. That's throughout history. That's not uncommon.
Right.
It's artists. And
they're ahead of the curve.
People in the
socially.
Humanities are ahead of the avant-garde.
Yeah.
Are the avant-garde. They see it before everyone else does.
That's right.
That's what happened. But it would not have happened had it not been for post-Judeo-Christian society and post-modernism. Then there's the Marxist element.
Right.
The Marxist element, not in the political economic sense.
Correct, socially.
But in the social brainwashing sense.
Yes.
In the sense of social brainwashing, where the masses can be, it's actually more Leninist than Marxist.
Professional
revolutionaries would control what the masses, what the lumpen proletariat thinks. With the lumpen proletariat, they would be controlled by a revolutionary elite who would tell them what to think and what to believe. But the philosophical root of this goes back not to Marx, it goes back to Rousseau in France.
That's correct.
None of these things are new. Let us remember, I have been saying, and to bring it back now to a biblical perspective, 25, 30 years ago, I first said this, the church is going to end up in the Western world what it was like for believers in the first century Greco-Roman world. One of the characteristics of that was that bisexuality, homosexuality, and lesbianism was seen as socially normative.
Yes.
Where people would claim an identity as a male or a female extraneous to their anatomical endowment.
Yeah.
Okay, that was the first thing I said was gonna happen. Second thing I said was, with the gladiators, violence is entertainment. Not violence for a cause or a war, this violence is mere entertainment. These video games, this is violence for the sake of violence. That was another major feature of the Greco-Roman world. I said that this is going to happen again. Third thing I said that was going to happen again, and we're talking now back in the late 80s, early 90s. Okay, it was when I really began to, I thought it before this, but I began teaching it in the early 90s. I said the next thing was going to happen is a reversion to religio licita and religio illicita as you had in Rome under the pontifical emperors. every religion is okay as long as you accept the validity of every other religion. And the pontiff would be the bridge builder between the faiths. It doesn't matter.
Right.
Then you'd be licensed. You'd be socially acceptable. Hmm. You can be a Buddhist. You can be a Christian. You can be a Jew. But once you become an exclusivist, once you say Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, nobody comes to the Father but through him. Amen. Now you are religio illicita. Religio illicita. I also said that what happened within the Jewish community in the first century, where Jewish believers were increasingly persecuted and forced out by the religious establishment. You're going to see a division of synagogues. You're going to see even rabbis like St. Paul turning to Christ in the last days. You're going to see what happened in the first century happen in the Jewish community before Jesus comes. That will happen again. The messiahship of Jesus will become a huge issue in world Jewry. And it's going to divide synagogues.
Already.
It's going to divide families. It's going to have all kinds of social and even political ramifications and legal ramifications. That's another thing I said was going to happen as the church becomes more and more Jewish in the sense of Christians realizing that it's gravitated away from its apostolic roots that were Judaic.
We had a gentleman here who came from a Jewish family, came to Christ as his Messiah, and he was the family disowned him, and they did Shiva for him, and they basically did a funeral for him.
Absolutely. This is going to become more of an issue. What else you found in the first century was this. In the first century, now follow what I'm saying. I've been saying this since the early 90s, late 80s. In the first century, you had the Greco-Roman worldview. They drew no distinction between astronomy and astrology.
Right.
Okay. What later became known as alchemy, they drew no distinction between chemistry, physics, and magic. It was all the same. Okay. What I said in the early 1990s, late 80s was this. In certain fields, computer video graphics and laser holography. Second, particle physics. Third, holistic medicine. Hmm. Particularly in holistic medicine, particularly in holography and computer video graphics.
Yeah, video games now.
Right? In particle physics, and then ultimately in biogenetic engineering. What you are going to see with the Enlightenment, there was a separation between science and the occult. Astrology went one way, astronomy the other.
True science versus...
Yeah, medical science and pharmacology went one way. Healing arts and folk medicine went the other way. Chemistry and physics went one way. Magic went the other way. You're going to see a rapprochement between science and the occult. In particle physics and holography and video graphics, you're going to see it in particle physics and you're going to see it in holistic medicine, and you're ultimately going to see it in biogenetic engineering. Mark my words. People are going to attempt to facilitate reincarnation by cloning. Hmm. It's only a matter of time someone will attempt to facilitate reincarnation by cloning.
You have a guy like Elon Musk who's working with physics guys, and they're saying that this is a video game. The reality is that this is a video game somebody created. You can be your own god by creating your own video game.
One of the things we said that was going to happen was this. Virtual technology would become so good. It began with the space program.
Right.
Then that same technology was used to train fighter pilots. Then that same technology was used to train commercial pilots. Finally, it's reduced to the level of computer games.
Yeah.
That technology is going to get better and cheaper and more easier to use.
Hmm.
People are going to put on a simulator that's going to look like a pair of sunglasses or a pair of glasses. I always wanted to be Napoleon. I always wanted to be Cinderella. I always wanted to be Elvis. The outside world, that's my 9-to-5 world.
Yeah.
This is my world. As soon as I'm out of there, hey, man, I'm Elvis. Oh, man. I'm Napoleon.
Yeah.
People are going to get so caught up in virtual technology that they will synthetically manufacture a false world that will become their reality. The subjective will become their functional objective. So they'll be so detached from reality, they'll be manipulated
Into anything.
Into anything.
Yeah.
That doesn't matter. I can take the mark of the beast. This is my real, I don't care what happened. That's the other world. This is my real world.
You know, Jacob, there's companies already that have come out with, if you want to see your favorite star,
yep.
Marilyn Monroe, hip-hop artist Tupac Shakur, you can go to their concerts. You can talk to them through hologram and holographics.
That's correct.
It's phenomenal.
But what you saw there, your gender is what you feel. No, your identity is what you feel. I'm Napoleon. I'm Elvis. I'm Cinderella. You know, I'm Marie Antoinette.
Yeah.
Don't think people won't do it.
Yeah.
And if Western governments begin putting restrictions on the use of this technology,
that's right.
You know, somebody else, some despot's going to allow it.
Yeah. What's filling the vacuum, Jacob, in the West, England, America, Australia, the Western world? Is you see the disintegration of what you're talking about, and then the vacuum effect of religion is. It's taking Islam is taking the place of that. I want you to watch this clip, Serge. If you have that clip, this is in the UK. This is a couple of weeks ago.
Yes.
Demonstration in London, where they're calling for a caliphate state in London. They're selling the same thing in America, but not as prevalent. Whenever you have that, Serge, you can play that. This is in London. This is near. Obviously, you live nearby.
Yes.
And you know what it's like in the.
I've seen it firsthand.
Yeah. Whenever you guys can, that would be great. And a couple of things that they're talking about. And there's another gentleman that comes up in Brussels who's saying, we're going to take over. And you guys can't stop it because of the birth rate. And so whenever you guys.
We need a Khalif who will clean up these streets and who will smack up armies and who will back beef. Backhand your missiles back to your land, that's the plan. Backhand your missiles back to your land, that's the plan. World domination at hand, we can expand and take out these.
Push us back or something like that. I don't know, maybe they can start to marry four wives and have a lot of children. Start with that, maybe they will have a chance, but I don't think so.
كذلك أوروبا كل أكفارها كلهم تقطر قلوبهم حقدا على المسلمين يتمنون لنا الموت ولكنهم فقدوا إخصابهم ويبحثون عن إخصاب عندنا سنخصبهم وسوف ننسل وسوف ننجب منهم فضل اللاجئين سنطلبهم منكم قريبا باسم دولة الخلافة القادمة.
Okay, let me respond to this. There are multiple aspects of this. The first of the prophecies of Daniel, the conflict of the kings of the north, the kings of the south, that will be recapitulated from the book of Daniel. Iran particularly arising as a threat from Daniel chapter 10. However, the overall problem, let no one tell you differently. After Muslims live in the West after two generations, their own birth rate begins to decline.
Interesting.
There is also a reaction and a resistance to Islam that's growing in Europe, that's coming in the form of European nationalism.
Hmm.
You even see it in countries that were highly tolerant, like Sweden.
Right.
There is a backlash.
Yeah, they just...
There is a backlash.
They deported all these Muslims.
Much the same as the globalism and the European agenda, you had a backlash with Brexit.
Right.
Much the same as the political correctness in the States, you had a backlash with Trump.
Yeah.
There is a backlash. Now, unfortunately, such nationalist movements also tend to become anti-Semitic. Eventually. But there is an absolute backlash. There will be a conflict of the kings of the north, kings of the south. Second aspect. This is the second aspect. There is an appeal to Westerners to this kind of absolutism. People are disoriented. Why are people like Farrakhan filling the vacuum in the Afro-American communities where Pentecostalism and Baptist grandmothers are no longer ruling the roost spiritually?
Right.
Okay, why is it being filled by Islam? When you have a high-tech society, 3 out of 4 black kids born out of wedlock, very few of them reaching the echelons of education they need for coding and computer programming on the level to make the very high incomes. Okay, they have no place in the coming economy. They have no place. It's a different world out there. They're totally displaced from it. What are they going to do? They're going to go to something that gives them a sense of identity and direction and tells them they're the victim.
That's right.
Hence, they'll go to the victim mentality, somebody offering it. You've got people who see the breakdown of the family. They see the divorce. They see we have nothing to hold on to. The Muslims will come and say, we'll give you moral values. You know,
We'll
give you absolute. That appeals to people's insecurity.
That's right.
It's like, you know, there's some kind of a movement of women who actually wear a collar, and they want men to control them and tell them what they, and a lot of them are actually educated women.
Yes.
A lot of them are actually, and it's hard to understand. They want somebody to give them a sense
of
identity. Just take care of me and I'll do what you
say.
That's
right. That's right.
I don't want to take the responsibility.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this thing becomes sociological. You see Western women marrying Muslim husbands. Indifferent to the way women are treated under Sharia and then the Islamic world, they're indifferent to it.
That's right.
And then they go into it. It's the same thing. Now, the third aspect is the politics of oil. I said repeatedly, the Bush family, the Saudi Arabians carried the Bush dynasty around in their back pocket. The Bush family continued to give, the Bush administration continued to give visas to Saudi Arabians, express visas, after September 11th for a full year. A full year. I've been to Saudi Arabia. I see what they do to Christians. I see what they do to women. I see what they do to Asians and to blacks. Hmm. I see the way they treat their foreign workers. The whole Sharia thing, it's not just about religion. It's about controlling the foreign labor force.
That's right.
Because almost all the jobs are done by them. Okay? It's about social and political control for economic reasons. But they use religion to achieve it. There's more to Salafism and Wahhabism than just religion. There's an economic, political agenda
in
controlling all these foreign workers or the underclass in Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabians continue funding radical mosques that engender support for jihad. And the Bush family, the Bush dynasty particularly, and Obama and Clinton had no problem keeping silent about it. No problem. CAIR, United States, that organization should be shut down.
That's right.
Three of its leading figures were found to be associated with terrorist organizations and fundraising, and they're still allowed to carry on.
That's right.
Not one Islamic country will give Christians the rights they get here, yet they come here and make themselves the victims. You're taking away our rights because you won't let us do to you here what we do in our countries.
That's right.
Oh, if you have Christmas, that offends us. We're Muslims. We don't allow it in Saudi Arabia, so therefore we shouldn't allow it in Detroit. This is the mentality of it. But when you have political whores in Congress and in the White House, political prostitutes,
allowing it,
people like the House of Bush,
who
just don't care, who are willing to sell the country down the river, give these people visas. Here's another one. Right where we are, San Bernardino. 14 people shot dead.
That's December.
14 people shot dead. They were living a half a mile from where I sleep at night when I'm here, in Midlands. 14 people. Hillary Clinton wants to bring in 56,000 Muslim refugees with no vetting, no way to know how many radicals are among them. Despite being warned by the Soviet, by the Russian security, Russian intelligence, the Clinton State Department gave the visas to the Boston Marathon bombers and their mother, who's a radical.
Like,
and she wants to bring more in. And if you don't bring more in, unvetted, oh, you're an Islamophobe! After Pearl Harbor, during the Second World War, not all Italians were fascists. Many Italians couldn't stand Muslims.
Right.
But we didn't give visas to Italians because we didn't know which Italians were pro-Mussolini and which ones weren't. Not all Germans were Nazis, but we didn't allow Germans to immigrate during the Second World War because we didn't know if they were Nazis or if they were anti-Nazi.
That's right.
So too, we didn't allow Japanese to immigrate to the United States during the Second World War. We didn't know if they were Japanese imperialists or if they weren't. You had no way to tell. Neither do you have any way to tell about an Islamic refugee or an Islamic immigrant.
And once they're here,
the next big lie. Here's the next big lie. It's only a small minority within them. It is not a small minority. you're probably talking not necessarily terrorists,
right,
but those who are pro-jihad and pro-sharia,
yeah,
you're probably talking 50% of the Islamic world.
Here's a picture, Jacob, of in London, openly a Muslim man wearing an ISIS flag. Nobody batted an eye because it was his right to express
That's
himself.
Right.
So these politicians are completely, I mean, we're under the judgment
Obama,
of the Lord.
Who funded the Clinton Library?
Yeah. The Saudis.
Look, if it was up to me, I'd put George Bush, Barack Obama, and Bill Clinton all on trial for treason.
That's right. I feel the same way. I think they've done so much to destroy this nation.
If it was up to me.
Yeah. This is a phenomenon that's occurring in Europe. They want, and mainly in America, we'll probably see it in a few years, is that they want to lower the age of consent for marriage.
Of course.
Because of this is obviously in the Muslim world, they could marry, following the example of their prophet, they could marry young girls.
That's correct.
Yeah, so it is a large push in Europe for child brides.
It'll come here. And it will probably have some support from fundamentalist Mormons who are doing the same thing already.
And pedophiles who want to normalize pedophilia.
That's correct. When you speak to fundamentalist Mormons, most of those girls are underage when they get married.
Incredible.
Islam is, don't forget, Islam and Mormonism are
fundamentally
angelic.
Yeah. Yeah.
What Colossians 2 warns about, taking your stand on a vision of an angel,
yeah,
that was Muhammad claiming Gabriel, and that was Joseph Smith claiming Moroni. They have the same kind of roots. That's why they do the same kind of things.
Yeah.
With the pedophilia and the polygamy, bigamy, they do the same things because they have the same demonic root.
And even we talked about earlier about the Catholic Church and pedophilia. They're very, very open to Islam, and they're very, very condescending, but they're very accepting of Islam in different countries. Even the Pope won't speak against it. The pedophilia in the Catholic Church, the pedophilia in the Islamic world, it's the same. It has the same kind of kindred spirit. Yeah,
it is absolutely the same. You know, let's speak about something. People don't want to say this. IQs, intelligence quotients, were never designed as a measure of intelligence.
Right.
They were initially designed to identify low intelligence, learning incapacity. IQs cannot measure creative intelligence.
Yeah,
a composer
can't.
Like
yeah,
Mozart.
You can't.
IQs cannot measure abstract reasoning. And in high science, advanced science, abstract reasoning is important, but there's no way to measure somebody's intellectual capacity for abstract reasoning. Additionally, an argument can be made and has been made that which letter follows Q in this sequence, it's not a measure of intelligence, it's just an identification of another kind of aptitude. Some people good in math, some people good in music, some people are good in the arts.
Pattern recognition and things like that.
But most people would agree it is a way to identify low intelligence.
Okay.
The lower IQs of Afro-Americans are purely cultural. The average lower IQs of Afro-Americans are purely cultural. There are too many blacks who have high IQs.
That's right.
It's purely cultural. There's something wrong culturally, the children being born out of wedlock and so forth, and the bad schools and so forth.
Yeah.
It's purely cultural. It's something you can correct.
Yes.
If there was a political will to correct it, you could correct it
with
education and with family values and so forth. It's purely cultural.
Yeah.
There's nothing genetically inferior about blacks. There is something genetically inferior about Muslims. They are like hillbillies. The level of inbreeding of 14-year-old girls marrying 54-year-old uncles, that is prolific. It's commonplace throughout Central Asia. From the Middle East all the way through Central Asia, it's common. It's normal.
That's right.
They are genetically inferior because of inbreeding, similar to the hillbillies of Appalachia. Same thing.
Yeah.
It is absolutely proven beyond any doubt.
This has been known.
It's not new.
No,
you require genetic diversity to have a healthy population.
Yeah.
At best, you're going for risks of things like hemophilia, which decimated some of the royal families of Europe in the 19th century. Okay. At best, there's risks of those kinds of things. But when you do that habitually, generation upon generation, you are breeding congenital idiocy. You are creating a genetic inferiority. Muslims are genetically inferior to non-Muslims because of inbreeding. It's what happened in Appalachia.
Yeah.
Or now, the what people happened in Appalachia were of Scotch-Irish descent, the original hillbillies, as we call them. They were of Scotch-Irish descent. But they inbred. Look, that like that movie Deliverance. It's not an exaggeration.
No,
that people were like that.
Yeah.
Well, imagine hundreds of millions of people
like that.
Like that. That is the Muslim world. You're dealing with a species that is genetically inferior to normal humans. It's not like black people in Africa and the United States or whatever, where it's purely cultural, where you can correct it with education and family values, where it's as a result of bad politics and bad moral values. It's not like that. Bad schools, it's not like that.
Or entertainment.
It's like genetic.
That. Yeah.
It's genetic.
Jacob, this fight between populism, we call nationalism, and globalism,
yes,
ultimately, biblically, where do you see it going? It's going to be a fight. It's going to be, it's already started. Catalonia wants to break away. Iceland wants to break away. Brexit, which hasn't happened yet because they're stalling it, the pushback against Trump. Where do you see this going?
Essentially, the nation state is being pulled to pieces from above and beneath. It's being pulled to pieces above by transnationalism. You can put customs and excise on manufactured goods and exports. How do you put customs and excise on information? You can control capital.
Right.
How do you control electronic capital?
Yeah, information science.
The nation state can no longer facilitate a global economy in the form the nation state was. That's pulling it apart from above.
Yes.
Underneath, there is a localism, a regionalism, a new ethnicity. People in Northern California are tired of LA and paying high taxes. They want to split California in two. There are people in the Michigan panhandle of the Northern, they want to call it Superior and separate it from the rest of Michigan. There's people who want to do that. There's people who say financially and economically that New York City and Long Island should become a separate state
that's
from
right.
New York.
That's right.
That would be better. That's what they're saying. Okay, this is happening all over the place. Local shoppers, local newspapers are doing well.
Yeah.
National dailies like the New York Times, the New York Slimes, and the Washington Compost, their circulation is declining rapidly.
Yeah.
Okay. The person who foresaw this was undoubtedly Alvin Toffler. Alvin Toffler wrote the book Future Shock and the Third Wave. Mm. If there was ever an analyst who saw what was going to happen in the sphere of socioeconomics,
that's right.
It was Alvin Toffler. I read Toffler's books when they came out in the 70s, whenever it was, and some of what he said did not seem plausible.
Back then,
Some of it seemed like it could be plausible, but virtually everything he said that was going to happen nearly has happened. You have a reaction against globalism.
Yes.
Because there's a loss not only of sovereignty, but of control. The problem that Britain had was not just the identity issue of having to bring in immigrants from other countries and refugees from other countries and losing their identity. That was not the only issue. The issue was most of their laws were being made by unelected socialist bureaucrats in Brussels who they didn't vote for and can't remove. Mm. The same trend is here. Barack Obama has set a record for executive orders.
Yes.
He's trying to govern by decree, by fiat, by signing executive orders, circumventing the Constitution to the point he made a treaty, a de facto treaty with
TPP.
Iran that has no legal credence. But he did it and got away with it and was not impeached. There is a reaction against this.
That's right. Now, if we can have the slide up, Tish, on the World Economic Forum, not too long ago, I think it was in July.
In Lausanne, Switzerland?
Yeah, that's right. They posted this article.
Davos.
Davos, that's right. Can we get that one, Miss Tish? Yes. Welcome to 2030. This is their idea of a society. I own nothing, have no privacy. Life's never been better. This is their ideal situation for individuals living in the world, basically living under a nanny state.
Well, let me tell you about the people who believe this. They're Eurocrats with astronomical expense accounts. They live in Strasbourg, they live in the suburbs of Brussels, and they live salubriously. You would not believe the benefit package these unelected socialist Eurocrats have. Look at that. I own nothing, I have no privacy, and life has never been better. That came from John Lennon singing Imagine. He lived in the Dakota. He had a mansion near where I live in England. about half, 25 minutes or 20 minutes from where I live in England. What was his house in Ascot? You wouldn't believe where he lived. The house was later sold for $55 million to the Sultan. He had a house in Long Island in Cold Harbor. He had a house in Virginia. Imagine no possessions. Yeah, I can imagine no possessions, but he couldn't. That's what these people do. They're singing Imagine. They're singing this New Age anthem. They're singing this postmodern anthem. They're singing this globalist anthem. That's what they're doing. But the people who control it, that's not their reality.
Will globalism win out? And it's a scriptural that we could say that we're going to see something of a kingdom that's going to come and overpower all other kingdoms.
I can answer your question precisely. Turn with me, please, to the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 2. Verse 32. The head of that statue was made of fine gold, its breast and its arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron and clay, its feet partially of iron and partially of clay. Remember, iron does not
mix with clay.
Cling to clay. They are trying to force the EU countries together. Weak economies like Greece do not congeal with strong economies like Germany. It's exactly what Daniel said is going to transpire. Well, let's continue looking. We read this. And we see in verse 41, in that you saw the feet and toes partially of potter's clay and partially of iron. It'll be divided kingdom, but it will have in it the toughness of iron, inasmuch as you saw the iron mixed with the common clay. And as the toes of the feet were partially of iron and partially of pottery, so some of the kingdom will be strong and some will be brittle. And in that you saw the iron mixed with common clay, they will combine with one another in the seed of men. They will attempt to socially engineer, okay? But they will not adhere to one another, even as iron does not combine with pottery. They will attempt to do it by every political, economic, sociological, and strategic means possible, and religious means possible. I've explained this was one of the reasons for the ecumenical agenda.
That's right.
What does somebody in Ireland, a Celtic country, have in common with somebody in Austria, a Germanic country, or somebody in Poland, a Slavic country, or somebody in Italy, a Latin country? It's not cuisine, it's not language, it's not history. It's nomine Patri, cum Filio, cum Spiritu Sancto.
Catholic Church.
They have to reverse the Reformation in order to help engender a kind of Holy Roman Empire. Remember, the Holy Roman Empire was neither holy nor Roman.
That's right.
The religion was controlled from Rome, but the economics and politics were controlled from Germany. That's what they're aiming for. But Daniel tells us it won't work. Not only does he tell us it won't work, but in verse 34, we read the following. You continued looking until a stone cut out without hands, and it struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and crushed them. That is the return of Christ, undoubtedly.
That's right. Now they're going to try.
They will never make the iron adhere to the clay. They'll desperately try it. But some of it will be strong, some weak. But the return of Jesus will bring about a wholesale destruction. Remember, this was the king of Babylon.
That's right.
The fall of this Babylon, this head of gold,
yeah,
that's the mind of the world.
Gold.
Foreshadows what's going to happen with the fall of Babylon the Great in Revelation. It's all going down with the return of Jesus.
Now, they're desperately trying to implement a cashless society. Sweden,
India.
I think we have the PowerPoint of that. It's the state of, I believe it's pronounced Goa.
Yeah.
Cashless society with basically a SIM sticker that's going to go into your phone, and you'll be able to. So they basically have outlawed the cash as of December 31st. It's going to go into your phone. You'll be able to buy anything you like, anything you would possibly buy with cash. It's going to go completely electronic. Will we see more of this, Jacob?
There's going to be an agenda to push it. I don't have any fantasies of the reality of it ever happening. But the best thing that could happen to the United States, the best thing would be the dissolution of the Federal Reserve System.
That's right.
And abolishing the Federal Reserve Bank.
Mm.
Replacing it with the Bank of the United States that was an agency of the Treasury Department. You have an unelected fourth branch of government that's completely non-constitutional, whose clients are the international banking establishment and are controlled by the international banking establishment and have more control over the economy than the administration or the Congress, ultimately, because of their capacity to issue debt, buy federal debt, and to control interest rates.
That's right.
You have an unelected, unconstitutional fourth branch of government. Central banking is dangerous to democracy. The best thing America can do is abolish the European Central Bank. The best thing Europe can do is to get rid of the euro, go back to the Deutschmark, the Gilder, and
That's
so
right.
forth. Now, I don't believe
it could happen.
Whether it's going to happen, it will be a miracle of God.
That's right.
Now, the second best thing the United States can do is abolish the IRS and get a flat rate tax. But that's only my opinion.
Yeah.
But the IRS,
it's been weaponized against conservatives.
That's correct. Nixon used the IRS as a political police force, and people went to prison over it. Obama used the IRS as a political police force, and that learner woman and that deceiving guy walked free.
Free, basically. Jacob, turning over to the Middle East and what's been happening in Syria, even today, what we talked about earlier in the morning, that not only is places like Aleppo, places like ancient Nineveh, which is basically Mosul, this is a war that I think the Bible describes it very clearly. That
Isaiah Damascus, 17.
Yeah.
Isaiah 17. The problem concerning, that's Damascus.
Yeah.
The problem concerning Aleppo is it was the main Christian city. Now I mean Christian in the broad sense.
Yeah. And, yeah.
Left in the Middle East.
Incredible.
Aleppo had more Christians than any other single city in the Middle East.
Now the mustard gas that was used apparently by ISIS, which is basically the rebels that they call them, which our government has been funding.
But let's not forget that the Syrian government of Assad
used it,
chemical weapons, and Obama drew the line and said, "If you do this, they did it, and he didn't keep his word." As a result, Obama is seen as weak,
correct,
and not someone you have to take seriously. Hence, the Iranians, the Russians, the Syrians. Nobody takes Barack Obama seriously. Nobody takes John Kerry seriously. Nobody over there takes Hillary Clinton seriously. They just don't take them seriously.
No.
The people with inimical to our interests don't take the present administration seriously. I only hope the new administration will be one who can be taken seriously.
Time will tell. This is what Iran said as of December 15th. I think we have the PowerPoint up there. Basically, Iran has broken basically the nuclear deal with the UN resolution. This is what they stated. We will have a new ballistic missile test in the near future. That will be a thorn in the eyes of our enemies, said President Rouhani. The range of the existing Iranian ballistic missile has grown from 500 miles to 1,250 miles, roughly about 2,000 kilometers, which can easily reach Eastern Europe as well as Israel. This is what they said December 15th. They basically, what you said about Obama being weak, they're laughing. They've
this
been laughing.
Was not even on the table
right.
in the negotiations that Kerry carried out. The delivery system was not even on the table.
In addition, Iranian Defense Minister General Hussein Dehghan said that there will be no limit for the range and amount of missiles that Iran will develop. Now, this is Syria. I think it's the next one, Tish, where you have Rouhani. Yes. Basically snubbing the UN resolution, basically snubbing Obama and saying, what you put down is laughable. We're going to make them. We're going to make them longer, yes. And we're going to make more of them.
Yes.
This is
the way that the Bush administration betrayed America and the West to Saudi Arabia is the way Obama betrayed America and its allies to Iran. There's no difference between Bush and Obama.
Right.
They both did the same kind of things. It's a rather frightening prospect. It all comes to Daniel chapter 10.
Okay, I was just going to ask you that.
It all comes to the 10th chapter of Daniel. Remember, when Jesus was born, Parthia was the potential threat to Europe. When he comes again, it's the same thing. Parthia, Persia, is the potential threat to Europe.
Will Iran launch a preemptive attack on Israel, knowing who the president is now, the president-elect?
Okay, there's no question that if there is two battles of Gog and Magog, if there are two, one at the end of the millennium and one before, if you subscribe to the view that there are two, one prefiguring the post-millennial one, that Iran will be involved in this attempt to destroy Israel.
Do you subscribe to that?
Because of the 7 months cleaning up the battlefield,
right,
that tends to persuade me.
Okay, that could be.
That there could be two.
Okay.
Okay?
All right.
And if that is the case, the stage is being set as we speak.
Because Turkey is absolutely
going. Turkey's going fundamentalist.
Yeah.
Putin's got a problem. When oil was $100 a barrel and higher, he did not invest in infrastructure or diversification of the Russian economy. It is an oil state.
Military, basically.
The price of oil has gone down. Russia and OPEC are never going to be able to do what they once did because of natural gas in the States and because of fracking. It's never going to be able to do the same thing to the same degree again. All Putin can do is play the nationalist card. Play the nationalist card with the external enemies in order to engender a unity within the Russian populace politically. Secondly, the man is embittered over having lost the Cold War. He is so embittered, as one person put it, he's willing to cut off his own arm if he can cut off our finger. He's embittered. His idea of trying to, if it hurts the West, if it hurts America particularly, we'll do it at the expense of our own people. He also had the ambition of creating instability in the Middle East to artificially drive up the price of oil and natural gas to help his own exports. But of course, that has not worked. That's all gone.
Right.
He's an unstable man. He's politically in a very tenuous position. Be careful. China is likewise in a tenuous position. I need to be careful about saying this.
Yes.
I don't want to say any more, but they will play the same kind of game. That's why they're doing what they're doing in the South China Sea.
That's right. I didn't have a clip, but we had a clip
before.
There is
an economic instability in China that can trigger a political upheaval, but I don't want to say any more.
Right. But China's in trouble economically as well.
China is in more trouble economically than people realize.
That's right.
It is not simply the building bubble. It is not simply the equity markets bubble that the government intervened to stop. There is a shadow banking system in China.
That's right.
When that thing goes,
look out.
Always follow the money.
Yeah.
The wealthy people of China and Russia, the oligarchs of Russia and the industrialists of China, went into capital flight. Massive removals of their capital assets from Russia and China into Europe and America.
Is that where they're buying all this property?
That's where they're buying up Beverly Hills. That's where they're buying up Central London.
Vancouver, Canada.
That is exactly what's happening. What do these people know that the others don't? Always follow the money. Watch what the wealthy do. Not the ordinary wealthy.
Yeah.
I mean the serious money wealthy.
Yeah.
Watch what they do. Well, watch what they're doing. Russia and China are both heading for trouble.
Incredible.
Both heading for trouble.
And this could precipitate a war.
It could precipitate a war.
Very, very. Switching gears, Jacob, this final topic, it's within the church. And you may want to comment on this. You may not want to comment on it. But this is about the Calvary Chapel Global Network, the breakup of it. What you've warned them before. You made some videos about it. You've got some very good friends like Paul Smith who supported you in your statements. You have other people who have not.
Okay, things that myself, George Bryson,
yes,
Paul Smith, things that we said, I suppose you might say we have been vindicated by history. They happened as we said. That does not make us prophets. You wouldn't need a lot of intelligence to see the way things were going and what was going to happen after Chuck Smith went to be with the Lord. It was all readily apparent to anybody who wanted to look at it. But it was not politically correct to say so. Many of these Calvary Chapel pastors knew this was coming, but they were keeping their cards close to their chest, not rocking the boat. I said it was inevitable that there was going to be some kind of a fragmentation of this movement. I also warned there was going to be a shaking and major Calvary chapels were going to hit a wall. I said that before Bob Coy.
Right.
That was the biggest Calvary chapel. I said it before litigation flying forth within the family of Chuck Smith.
That's right.
It's not just Brian Broderson that's the problem. The problem is also Greg Laurie. He's willing to compromise with people who have aberrational doctrines that are not in harmony with what Chuck Smith ever taught or believed.
And this
they're not secondary issues.
Yeah.
They are not peripheral issues, correct, as he says. Many evangelists, and he's mainly an evangelist,
correct,
they think as long as we're preaching the gospel, we can put discipleship on the back burner. If you look at what is being taught by the people he's in bed with, including Rick Warren, these things are heretical.
Yeah.
These things are not minor doctrinal aberrations.
Correct.
These things are fundamental. Rick Warren saying that we have to unite with Hindus and Buddhists and Muslims to bring in global peace. And he's going along with Rick Warren.
Yeah.
It is not just Brian Broderson.
It's other leaders.
Greg Laurie is a cancer within the body of Christ in the United States. He is a cancer.
Some of the troubling relationships also with the connection to Bethel, the connection to Bill Johnson.
Absolutely.
To these music groups.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's
absolute. Look, the fragmentation was inevitable.
Correct.
I even named the ones who were going to fragment.
Yeah.
And they did. But it's only the beginning.
Yeah. And we see the apostasy in the church, Jacob, growing extensively and rapidly. Here's a picture of the Presbyterian church saying, you know, it's great that we finally accepted gay marriage. And you see
the PCA, pastors. Presbyterian Church in America. Yeah. Notice they were the first major American denomination to publicly condemn Israel.
Yeah.
They kept ignoring the reality of the persecution of Christians in the Arab world.
Yeah.
Ignoring the realities of Hamas and of Hezbollah, they condemned Israel aggressively. Well, that's what they are.
Yeah.
That's what they are.
Incredible. Not just them, but also you have the Methodist, the Methodist denomination as well.
Correct.
Yeah. Some part of the Lutheran denominations have gone that way. The United Church of Christ recently came out, this is last week, we're going to stay silent on terrorism, they said, because we just want a peace church. This is what Jesus wanted, a peace church. So we are not going to condemn terrorism against Israel, against other, even the persecuted church, because they said the Palestinian has the right to live there. And this is quote unquote, they said, until we have a choice that Palestinians can live in Israel free in the land, and Israel ends its occupation, then peace will follow, they said.
First of all, as I've said 10,000 times, an Apache cannot occupy Arizona. The archaeological record shows that the Jews are the indigenous people of that land, not Arab Muslims. It is not an occupation. An Irishman cannot occupy County Tipperary. A Maori cannot occupy Rotorua, New Zealand. An Apache cannot occupy Arizona. Neither can a Jew occupy the West Bank of the Jordan. That's to begin with.
Yeah.
On top of what the scripture teaches prophetically about the Jews returning. The fact of the matter is the Arabs who live in Israel have a higher standard of living and a higher standard of freedom than the Arabs in almost any of the surrounding countries anywhere. the standard of living of Arabs in the West Bank increased 320% under the Israelis, in terms of everything from infant mortality to employment to longevity. 370% in Gaza before Hamas took over and the Palestinian Authority took over. It's only after the Israelis left that it began to deteriorate. It is all lies and hypocrisy.
Yet they have conferences like at Jerusalem, the checkpoint, the crash point.
When you approach these people like Gary Burke,
right,
or Colin Chapman about the civil rights and the persecution of Christians in the surrounding countries, and that Israel is the only country in the Middle East that will protect the religious freedom and human rights of Arab Christians,
that's right,
they will not deal with the issue. They refuse to answer the question.
Church is in trouble, Jacob. Church is in trouble.
State publicly that Gary Berg is a theological fraud. I will debate that phony anywhere. We're going to debate the human rights record of Israel compared to the human rights record of the Palestinian Authority of Hamas and what happens to Christians in any of the surrounding Arab nations.
That's right.
Then he can tell me why he's singling out Israel when Israel has the best human rights record. For homosexuals,
even
Christians.
Correct. Switching gears, Jacob, as we're winding down, there's been, we talked about this earlier, Mr. C. Peter Wagner did a lot of damage to the church, the body of Christ, and he passed away in October. And we also had a false prophet, Kim Clement, who also passed away. These men really destroyed the church. These men really affected the church. These men brought false hope. These men deceived a lot of people. These are the people that Jesus warned about. These are the people that are going to increase, unfortunately, in numbers, because not only do they have a platform in the church, but even good denominations, even good churches are lining up with them, especially the New Apostolic Reformation.
Let's go to Lakeland. Todd Bentley was prophesied over by C. Peter Wagner.
Yes.
C. Peter Wagner inherited Donald McGavran's chair at Fuller. That's how he came into prominence and was influenced by people like Wimber. C. Peter Wagner, Bill Johnson, Che An, and Rick Joyner laid hands on Todd Bentley and prophesied over him how he was going to lead the Great Revival. This was a criminally convicted bisexual pedophile. Claims he became a Christian, and after becoming a Christian, had his body covered with tattoos, facially, his neck, his head, everything. That's who he is. While they prophesied over him, he was engaged in an adulterous relationship. 72 hours after their false prophecy, Bentley left. Bentley was banned from Great Britain. He's banned from Australia. Because of film footage of him kicking old ladies in the face and things like this. 72 hours after Peter Wagner, Bill Johnson, Rick Joyner, and Cheyenne prophesied over him, he left his handicapped wife, his handicapped Christian wife, he left her. He left his three children and took off to Hawaii with this woman who he was committing adultery with.
Yeah.
Divorced his Christian wife, left her and his kids. Children. Marries this other woman who he was committing adultery with. And then he's restored to ministry by those people, by Rick Joyner and co. Now the woman who he ran off with and was committing adultery with, she's prophesying with him.
Yeah.
He no longer talks about getting visitations from a female angel called Emma. Now he says he's getting visitations from a male angel called International Banker. Oh my God!
You know,
is Rick Joyner. This is Peter Wagner. This is what they promote.
I talked to a pastor who was hosting Mr. Bentley at one of his crusades, and we asked him straight out, "How would you allow somebody to divorce his wife like that and be in an adulterous affair?" And it's interesting. This is I get a lot of this from pastors. They say, "Who are we to judge? Everybody has sinned." And we're not going to keep him from the anointing of the ministry. And it is unbelievable to deal with people like that. You can't. These are churches that are allowing this.
And they have no biblical compass for where they're going.
Yeah.
The Word of God says he must be the husband of one wife. He must have a good reputation with those outside the church. The man is immoral. Who are we to judge? If the scripture says it's wrong, God has judged.
Yeah. You know, they promise revivals. They promise this. Jacob, is there...
It's a con job.
Are we going to see a revival coming, at least in the Western world?
I have been saying since the 1980s, and I repeat it whenever asked. When I lived in Israel, the Lord showed... I don't get prophecies every week or every 2 weeks or anything like that. I believe the Lord, and I stand by this, I believe it was the Lord showing me. If revival comes to the Western world, to countries like the United States, if revival does in fact come, it will be a King Josiah revival. It will delay the inevitable. Because the sins of King Manasseh in killing the babies were so great, even though a revival came and there was an authentic repentance, the judgment of God could only be delayed. It could not be prevented. I believe the genocidal atrocity of non-therapeutic abortion has left the Western world, including the United States and Israel, so blood guilty, the judgment of God is inevitable. Mm-hmm. A revival, if it was a real revival, can delay the judgment of God, but I don't believe it can prevent it. We are blood guilty.
Yeah. You know, a lot of times, Jacob, when I hear churches talk about revival, they talk about the Sunshine Revival, they talk about Wesley, they talk about Edwards, and it seems like we keep looking to the past.
Yes.
And we don't look ahead to the coming of Jesus.
What's more absurd is they call hype revival.
Yeah.
They're calling hype revival. The last time there was a revival, a real revival in the United States, was the Jesus movement among the hippies.
You were part of that.
I got saved in it. I saw guys coming back from Vietnam totally strung out on heroin. I mean, they were getting 100 to 120 milligrams of methadone a day at the VA clinic in L.A. or New York or Chicago. These guys were seriously strung out on Chinese smack. Getting saved, quitting, no cold turkey, nothing.
Just like that.
When you see the real power of God, people... psyched out on acid and free love and whatever. People, the whole drug culture.
Yeah.
When you see people being saved in the thousands and thousands of people a week.
Yeah.
Hippies. When you see the real, that's how Calvary Chapel came into existence.
Correct.
That is how Jews for Jesus came into existence.
Yeah.
Now, unfortunately, a lot of these groups became cults. Children of God, Church of Bible Understanding, the Bible speaks, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But when you see the real thing,
how can you?
You're never going to call this nonsense on TBN a revival.
Yeah. They hype it up, they promote it.
I was just in Vietnam 2 weeks ago. These people are being persecuted, and the churches are growing.
Praise God.
They're being persecuted unspeakably.
Praise God. Praise
I was with the pastor, he had somebody in his church. They burned the guy's house.
Hmm.
He and his daughter got out alive. They burned his wife and four of his children alive. This is 2 weeks ago. This is what I was dealing with in Vietnam. And the church is growing anyway.
Yeah. Amazing.
The news doesn't report it. Yeah. What happens to these Hmong people, the mountain people?
Yeah. Jacob, one of the things I've seen with this these false teachers, it's totally have corrupted and confused believers, especially new believers, on the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Could you describe basically, Jacob, to a new believer, or even a believer who's been confused by this this nonsense? What is the role of the Holy Spirit?
Okay, our first and foremost, Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of holiness.
Okay,
remember of all the churches that Paul wrote to, you had the confused Thessalonians, you had the legalistic Galatians, okay? You had some churches with some serious problems, but the church he warned the most about the Holy Spirit was the hyper-charismatic Corinthians.
Yeah.
It's the same today.
Yeah. I mean, people go
why
into cessationism.
Why is it you see more immorality and sex scandals among
Pentecostals.
Pentecostals.
Yeah.
The power of the Holy Spirit is the power of holy living. I was a cocaine addict. I injected cocaine. I sold cocaine. My life revolved around cocaine and other drugs. That's what I did. I didn't see it as a drug problem. I saw it as a lifestyle choice. The only drug problem I ever had was when I began running out. That was my problem. I didn't care. I did. That was it. I was addicted. I was an addict. My life was drug oriented, and then there was sexual immorality and all that. But it was drugs was the main. If you gave me a choice between a beautiful woman and a shot of coke, I would have taken the drugs over the chick. That's how much. There had to be something more powerful.
That's right.
Than that, to make me stop doing it. And that was when Jesus filled me with his spirit.
Amen.
I haven't taken a shot of cocaine since. Amen. I haven't rolled a joint since. I haven't smoked a cigarette since. That is the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, I've got other issues in my life. Yes, we all do. We all struggle with things. But if you saw what I was like before I was saved, my God, this guy was a degenerate. He was a drug addict. He was a dealer. That's the power of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And I'm not I can say the same about alcoholics, homosexuals, prostitutes, people in prisons, criminals. That's the power of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Then talk to me about charismatic gifts.
Yeah.
Then talk to me, you know, about charismata. Yeah. But first talk to me about moral living.
Yeah. What's now in a believer's life, what's the role of the Holy Spirit now as a believer? I mean, we relate to God the Father and Jesus. But
okay, the Holy Spirit empowers us to fulfill the work of Christ. But he unites and empowers us. But he convicts the world concerning sin,
righteousness,
and judgment.
That's right.
Okay. So he has a function towards the world and a function towards the body of Christ, towards
that's
believers.
Right. That's right. It's obviously he's within some the false circles. He's put in as the main light. Like they put him in as the main aspect of our faith.
The Holy Spirit always points people to Jesus, never himself.
That's right.
Never. If you see the Holy Spirit being lifted up above Christ, that's not the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit always points people to Jesus, never himself. The only time the Holy Spirit is ever prayed to in Scripture is in the context of the Trinity.
Yeah, Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
That's
Amen.
Right.
Jacob, final thing, and we're done. What is the church supposed to be doing? You see 2017, you see we're 7 days away. What is the church supposed to be doing? What's the call of the church? What's final words for believers that are going to be watching this and saying, what are
keep
we supposed to do?
Keep fulfilling the Great Commission as long as the Lord allows us to do so. Keep fulfilling the Great Commission. Not make converts, make disciples. That is first and foremost. Now, what I would also say is the teaching of Paul in Romans 13 and elsewhere. Pray for President Trump and Vice President Pence, who is a believer. I'm not saying he is perfect. I'm not saying this or that. I'm just saying he's in that position because God has allowed him to be there.
Yeah.
Please pray that he presides in righteousness. In righteousness. That Vice President Pence has a moral influence on his policies concerning same-sex marriage and these other issues.
Abortion and things like this,
that he keeps his word.
That's right.
Concerning the Supreme Court and staffing it with people who are pro-life and so forth. Please pray that this will be the period of respite that God is giving us.
Oh, we pray for that.
Maybe it'll be the last chance before Jesus comes, but we need to pray for the new president and pray for Britain and Brexit.
That's right.
Please pray.
This could be
God giving the English-speaking nations one more chance to repent before the Lord comes. That's all I want to see.
Yeah.
It's more than we deserve.
Yeah.
It's more than we deserve, that's for sure. But it might be our last chance before Jesus comes.
Yeah.
We need to pray. We need to pray. Pray also that the Lord raises up righteous leaders in the church.
Mm.
Gets rid of the theocrats.
That's right.
I've been so disillusioned by so many people I once respected.
Mm.
There are some good people, but I warned about this some years ago. I said in Great Britain, when Martin Lloyd-Jones went to be with the Lord, And F.F. Bruce, the great scholar, went to be with the Lord. And Campbell Morgan went to be with the Lord. That was the end of it. That was the end of the great tradition that went back to Charles Spurgeon and so forth.
Right.
That was the end of it. I said, in America, what's going to happen when Dave Hunt, David Wilkerson are no longer here?
Right.
When Chuck Smith is no longer here? Well, they're no longer here. Is there going to be another generation of leaders coming up? So far, I don't see them. I see America going the way of Britain. I would like to see another generation coming up. Again, he's not perfect, but I do believe he loves the Lord. Pray for Franklin Graham. Many people are disillusioned with Billy Graham, and for good reason.
Right.
Pray for Franklin Graham. He's somebody worth praying for. I don't know. I just believe it's important that we pray for Franklin Graham.
That's right.
Something else. Please pray that God will raise up a doctrinally solid believer in the Hispanic community and in the Afro-American community. Pray that we get an ethnic Hispanic and an Afro-American who are in it 100% for Jesus, who are well grounded in the word. We need to have leaders in those communities.
That's right.
Urgently.
That's right. Jacob, how can we pray for you? How can we pray for Moriel this coming year, 2017?
Well, first of all, pray for the salvation of Israel and the Jews. That's the best thing you can do for Moriel.
That's right.
Is to pray for the salvation of Israel and the Jews. We have an evangelistic project that we're working on that we do need prayer for. It's going to take a lot of prayer, and it's going to take a lot of money, frankly. And we're trusting God, but we want to go forward with it. It's an evangelistic project. I'll tell you about it in brief. We're putting them on the internet, but we want to put them in certain newspapers. Picture of Einstein. Are you a smart Jew? Einstein was a smart Jew, and this is what he said about Jesus. I am a Jew and nothing but a Jew. Yet as a Jew, I'm intrigued and even fascinated by the Nazarene, by Jesus. Nobody can dismiss. I have no doubt as to the historicity of Jesus in the New Testament. Nobody can dismiss the claims of Jesus as a bon mot. There's no question about it. Einstein was a smart Jew, are you? And then quote from Isaiah 53 in Hebrew and in English. Another one. Show me one Jew who believed Jesus was the Messiah, who amounted to anything, and a picture of Benjamin Disraeli, and a picture, and his quote, he said, the New Testament and Christianity is nothing but completed Judaism.
That's right.
The Old Testament means nothing without the New Testament revelation of Christ, and the New Testament revelation of Christ accounts for nothing unless you understand it. It's fulfillment of the Old. Then we have a verse from Jeremiah 31. I'll make a new covenant.
That's right.
One of the two I'm working on right now. One is, show me one top Jewish lawyer who was convinced on the basis of the evidence that Jesus was the Messiah. It's a picture of Simon Greenlee, founder of Harvard Law School.
That's right. That's right.
That is quote. And then the other one I'm working on at the moment is.
Is it the Mendelssohn?
Yeah. Felix Mendelssohn. Show me one Jew who believed Jesus was the Messiah who didn't suffer from a total lack of creativity. Felix Mendelssohn, composer of Hark the Herald Angels Sing. he wrote the music.
Yeah.
Things like this. And then it says, show me one rabbi who believed Jesus was the Messiah. What, only one? And I got like 20 of them, and you click on it with their testimonies. So that's an evangelistic project we're working on, and we hope to launch it in the forthcoming year. But we do need prayer, and we need prayer for money. These things are cheap. But that, and obviously the needs of Moriel, there's always the financial element, but that's not the main thing. We take care of kids in the third world. We're hoping to open in India. in addition to our works. And we need a missionary couple to go to Uganda. We desperately need some missionaries to work with AIDS kids in Uganda.
A huge issue there.
And we're hoping to open Moriel Latin America, working here with Sergio. We're hoping to open in Latin America. And, of course, our work with the persecuted church in Vietnam and certain other places. So there's always all those things, just prayer for all those things. Personally, well, obviously, there's the personal needs, but my health and family. Family first. For my family and for my health, those are the main things. There's other things, but those are the main things, obviously. I can't do the things I used to do. I just can't.
Right.
And it's difficult getting used to being handicapped. So your prayers are much appreciated. That the Lord will meet all the needs, not just of Moriel and myself, but the needs of the people we help. That's important.
Thank you, Jacob. I know this was a final trip of the year, at least in the United States here in Devore. We thank you so much for coming. It's been a wonderful blessing to talk to you, to interview you, to share what's on your heart, to know what the Lord is showing you, what you need to do, but also to encourage and to strengthen the body of Christ here. And Merry Christmas. Happy
thank
Hanukkah.
You.
Happy New Year. And we look forward to you coming back.
God bless you.
Thank you, guys.